I was coming out of my play, and there was a young man on the sidewalk holding a guitar, so I figured he wanted me to sign it. But he said, no, I want to give it to you. And I looked at it, and I could tell right away that it was beautifully made, you know. So I brought it home, and I looked at it, and it played beautifully. It sounded gorgeous. And the wood in it, it had a variety of different types of wood that really was, it was a real piece of craftsmanship. And so I left it in my living room. And when I started to feel the urge to write, I just picked it up because it was such an easy play, you know. And most of the songs came pouring out of it, so I owe a debt to whoever that young man is or wherever he is. But instruments have power in and of themselves. Guitars are inspirational, and they do hold songs within them. So it's wonderful to discover them. I had a close friend of mine from my very first band who was very, very ill and had a few weeks to live, and I went and I visited him down south where he lived. And he was the last surviving member of my very first band besides myself. So when he passed away, it left just me. And it was a very strange feeling, sort of thinking back to your youth and all of those people who meant so much to me at that time, all being gone. And so that started to, I wrote a song called Last Man Standing. And once I wrote that, the dam broke and all the other songs followed in about 7 or 10 days. And so that was on that guitar that the kid gave me.
Hear the sound of your guitar. Coming from the mystic fire.
There were no 25, 30-year-old guys playing rock and roll music. There were only kids playing. And so it was a fascinating and a sort of a golden age where there were venues everywhere, VFW, Union Halls, Elks Lodge, Knights of Columbus, high school dances, pizza parlors, bowling alleys, firemen's fairs, carnivals. There were so many different places your band could play and hone its craft, you know, so it was an amazing time. It's the first time that I chose that as my subject, the music itself. You know, it's about rock and roll, it's about being in a band over your lifetime. So it encompasses me reflecting on my first band with the early members from 1965. And reflecting on the band, of course, the E Street Band that I've been in now for the past 45 years. So, the subject is the music itself and the world that we've created with our fans.
Click down the hall, but never arrive.
It's lovely, you know. It's very. You know, it's a very common experience for us, but it's the experience of having all of the band in the room at one time right now is a real sweet benediction in my life, and it's something I enjoy deeply. We actually recorded the record in 4 days, and on the fifth we listened and told stories. So, it was just a great process, you know. You can't predict how these things are going to happen. Spent about three hours a song. The band played entirely live. All the vocals are first takes. So it was just a unique and wonderful experience for us to have so far down the road, you know. It was a real throwback to, if I think about the few other songs that I'd say we cut everything live. There was Darkness on the Edge of Town, from Darkness, Born in the USA, from Born in the USA. But most other songs, even where we cut the band live, the vocals would be overdubbed, you know? Not in this case. Well, I usually make demos, which is always a mistake, because you make a demo and you get very attached to it, and then you don't want to lose things on it. And so the first thing that I didn't do was I didn't do any demos, which the band suggested. Somebody said, hey, don't demo anything. That way the first time you hear it, you'll hear it fresh with the band playing it. So I just recorded them on my little iPhone with just me and the acoustic guitar, and I didn't do anything else until the band came into the studio. Then I would stand and play the rest of the song for the band. They'd learn it, and then we'd go into the booth and into the room and perform it. We spent about 3 hours a song, about two songs a day, and in about 4 days to 5 days, we were pretty much finished. Sound that was just the basic band. I didn't want horns, I didn't want strings, I didn't want any extraneous instruments. I wanted two keyboards, guitars, bass, drums. I just wanted the raw sound of the band the way it existed on, say, Darkness on the Edge of Town. And so it really suited itself for immediate and live recording. I cut one of them is called Janie Needs a Shooter, and I thought we have a record store day in the States where you put out a cut or two. So I said, gee, that was an interesting song, and I just cut it for that day. But once we were done with it, it sounded so good. I said, now this is the beginning of an album. And so then it made me think, well, I might have another one or two that I'd be interested in hearing the band interpret. And so I found this, If I Were the Priest. Like I said, it was one of the first songs I auditioned with. And then there's another song called Song for Orphans, which was just kind of hanging around and a favorite of mine. So they just kind of happened by accident, but it was a lot of fun to sing in the mind of your 22-year-old self with your older voice. You know, it was quite a treat. It's one of those songs that it had the great title, and so you start with that. You go, House of a Thousand Guitars, that's a good song title. Now, what am I going to say about it, you know? And so I sort of said, well, I'm going to write a song about the world that I've created with my fans and with my band. And so it sort of is a song encompassing the spiritual dimension, emotional dimension, intellectual dimension of what I've created alongside of my audience over all these years. And so I believe it's one of my best songs, and it's definitely at the center of this, of the record. So I'm glad you enjoyed it. Unusual thing about rock bands. Now imagine you are in high school, and then imagine you're 70 years old, and imagine that you have worked with the same people your entire life. There is no business in the world where that occurs, with the exception of a rock and roll band. There is no job in the world where that conditions. It's inconceivable, with the exception of a rock and roll band. So it's a privilege and an honor and a miracle to have sustained all those relationships over that long a period of time, because it takes quite a bit of social skills and tolerance for the other guy's foibles, point of view, and their tolerance for mine. So it's quite challenging, but if you can do it, it's quite rewarding. But it was, I regret not filming when I was younger. If I had it to do over again, I would have filmed a lot more of the band when we were younger. I'm lucky that we have the film of the band that we have from when we were younger, because I was very against it and very superstitious about it, about the magician looking too close at his magic trick. But so I knew that if the band was going to get together, we did not have a document of the band recording together in the studio, and so I knew that that's what I wanted.
And the morning sky of blue.
The act of filming the band is similar to the act of the band recording, in the sense that to be at your creative best is to be ready when opportunity presents itself. In other words, we come into the studio, just so happens to snow that day. All right, we look at the snow. There's a little bit of snow on film. Then the next thing I remember is Tom sends me some footage of somebody in the snow. And he said, All of a sudden we say, yeah, well, the snow seems like a good metaphor for us right now. And Danny Clinch calls me up the end days of my Broadway performance and asks me to come out in New York. Come out in New York on the afternoon when there's a freak blizzard. So all the pictures he takes of me are in the snow. So suddenly, snow becomes a very active character in both the art for the record and the film. And so if you're a good artist, you're picking that information up and you're using it. Tommy is very, very good at this. And so you follow where the real world is taking you. And so we ended up with the beautiful drone footage that Joe DeSalvo, a cinematographer, shot, that's in the film. And the snow became a very, very big player in the movie and in the recording art. So you have to be ready when those things happen to take advantage of that moment. That's a big, big part of things. And then the narration comes from me wanting to expand upon the written song. And it was a template that we worked out on Western Stars, where there was a song and then a meditative spoken word piece about the general, the subtext of that piece of music. And we followed that and expanded upon it in this film. And Tom and I Tom is really, really good at what I give him. He just makes gold out of it. If I send him a voiceover, if I send him a piece of music, of theme music, and then he puts it to image, we have been really, really good at doing that together. So it's been a blessing of a partnership.